good morning, everybody, and thank you, Alan, for that very warm New York City welcome in stark contrast to the New York City weather. So, please bear in mind whilst I set the scene. I'll explain this quite curious slide in a few minutes, but I need firstly to get everybody's heads in gear, especially as it's a Sunday morning. It's still only 11 o'clock. I don't know about you, but I'd probably still be in bed at this time on Sunday, reading the newspapers, or maybe even in church. But in today's digital world, where shoppers can buy anything, anywhere, and at any time, you'd be forgiven for thinking that luxury retail brands have had their day. But in reality, this couldn't be further from the truth. Luxury retail department stores are enjoying record profits. So why is this? The major luxury stores in London, Harrods, Selfridges, and Fortnum & Mason, all use their stores as brand temples. They've curated their own worlds that customers buy into. And this demonstrates that British heritage brands have global attraction, especially when combined with that other attribute that London is famous for, creativity. And it's worth reminding ourselves at this point, why do department stores exist at all? It's my belief that a luxury department store exists as an edit to the world's most desirable and sought-after products. Buyers scour the world for the exclusive, the unusual, the exotic, beautifully crafted items, brands with history and with provenance. And the values and mythology that come with a heritage brand like Harrods, combined with excitement that creativity delivers, is surely an intoxicating formula. Becoming customers of a brand experience and now using digital technology to bind a relationship with a global audience, heritage brands are proving that they are still highly relevant today. So back to my curious slide. I guess you're wondering what a baby elephant has got to do with digital innovation. Well, I'm going to tell the story about Gertie, the baby elephant, shortly. But what this picture does show is that Harrods has always been pushing the boundaries. It's always been an innovator, a little eccentric, very British, no matter the nationality of its ownership. It's always been an exciting place to visit, providing an extraordinary experience. Times have certainly changed, and Harrods has been adept at changing with it. And this whole new world of digital gives us a new realm in which to play in. But let's face it, is it really anything new? Luxury retail has always been about excitement and innovation. And Harrods isn't really doing anything very differently today from what it's always done. It's just using today's digital platform. So today I'm going to share with you three things. Firstly, a color story in beauty, which is really about branding awareness through digital content to engage, to entice and excite the customer. Secondly, store brand takeovers, which drive brand sales, profitability, and global PR. And this type of exhibition also drives new customers to the store. And I'll share with you the important part that digital played within this. And finally, a new department opening, Shoe Heaven, with specific financial goals and targets. And I'll share the part that digital media played to ensure a successful opening and the tactics that were employed to appeal to a younger, fashion-conscious customer within a highly competitive retail environment. So before covering the digital examples, I need to set the scene and explain a little bit about where Harrods has come from. So hands up somebody or anybody that's never heard of Harrods. Wow, that's amazing. Considering we don't really do very much international marketing, it's amazing the power of brands and its global entity. But for those of you that are familiar with Harrods, a little bit of a history lesson. In 1834, Charles Henry Harrod, yep, that's why Harrods is called Harrods, first established a small draper's business in the East End of London, which then developed into a grocer's store. And in 1849, the Great Exhibition in Hyde Park, he saw an opportunity to cash in with the trade that this promised. But this also gave him the perfect opportunity to escape the famous pea super smogs that were so common in the East End of London at that time. So he moved his business to the wider open spaces of Knightsbridge in West London and established a shop on the same site where the store stands today. Charles's son Digby then developed the business, and in 1888, Harrods employed over 100 staff. One Christmas, the store burnt to the ground. Remarkably, despite this calamity, Charles not only survived, but also managed to fulfill all of his Christmas deliveries that year, and also made a record profit into the process. And I think that's something a few of our online retailers would be quite jealous of this Christmas. So in 1883, Harrods, the building was rebuilt to the magnificent Terracotta Palace, which is the building that you see today. And it's just worth pausing for a moment, thinking about that date. The Eiffel Tower in Paris was built around that time. The California Gold Rush was in full swing. And it was still a good number of years before the motor car had been invented. Over the next 100 years, Harrods became the store that you could buy anything and everything, with its Latin motto of Omnia Omnibus Ubique, all things for all people everywhere. Harrods traded on its reputation for offering merchandise from and to the world over. And this picture actually shows a Harrods home removal service in action in Venice, no doubt delivering some furniture at the same time as part of the process. So fast forward to 2010. Harrods owner for 25 years, Mohammed Al-Fayed, sold the store to Qatar Holding, the sovereign wealth fund of the state of Qatar, for $2 billion. I'm not sure who looks the happier in this picture, but it certainly made global headlines. And this came only weeks after a denial that Harrods was for sale. Everything clearly has its price. And since then, over $250 million has been invested, bringing the store back to its former glory, with a host of new department openings. The business has thrived, and today employs over 5,000 staff. It generated a 10% increase in sales last year to over $1 billion, with pre-tax profits up 24% to $200 million. The store occupies a 5-acre site, has over 1 million square feet of selling space, over 330 different departments, making it the biggest luxury department store in Europe. Harrods attracts over 14 million customers every year from 130 different countries every month. It's also London's third biggest tourist attraction, keen to snap up those Harrods souvenirs and delicacies from the food halls. But as well as the tourists, the profits are really driven by the world's wealthiest people from the Middle East, the Far East, China, and Russia, who all shop in Harrods. 75% of Harrods' loyalty customers own a home within 3 miles of the store. And this really demonstrates the allure of London for the super rich, who value its cosmopolitan and international makeup, the strong economy, the stable political climate, and also, very importantly, the excellent education standards for their children. But today, people's tastes have changed. What was once cool, exotic, and de rigueur may now be viewed as crass or uncomfortable. So this brings me back to Gertie, the baby elephant we saw on the first slide. In 1967, Gertie was sourced for Harrods by the King of Albania, who purchased the elephant from Harrods as a gift for the Governor of California, a certain Mr. Ronald Reagan. And legend has it that the sales assistant who picked up the call that day from the Albanian embassy paused for a moment, only to respond with, "Would that be an African or an Indian elephant, sir?" I don't think Nancy was overly impressed, and not surprisingly, Gertie wasn't allowed in the house. So Gertie ended up living a long and happy life in the Los Angeles Zoo. And animals feature large in Harrods history, whether it be, as you can see here, Hollywood stars cuddling puppies for the world's press photographers, or pampered pooches being brought to a pet spa in Harrods. Or the heart-rending story of Christian the Lion, a lion cub purchased from Harrods in the swinging 60s. If you haven't seen it or are not familiar with it, do check it out on YouTube. It's had over 100 million hits globally. And it's a wonderful story. And Harrods was very much the go-to place for exotic pets in London, selling tigers, panthers, and lions. Quite unbelievable to think of that today. But with changes in attitudes to animal welfare, it has meant that these often very special, very unique departments that Harrods once offered to entice customers have now gone. And the only animals we sell today are these lions and these elephants sitting in between these chairs over here. So at this point, maybe just to break things up a little bit, there's actually two business cards stuck under a seat. If you all like to just check your underneath your seat, because two people are going to win, Goethe the Elephant and Christian the Lion. Perhaps if you'd like to have a look now and then come and see me at the end to claim your lovely prize. Being Harrods, these of course are not any old stuffed toy. They're actually Steiff toys from Germany, the finest manufacturer of stuffed toys in the world. Any luck? Keep looking. Well, I tell you what, when you find it, come and see me at the end. We also have some Harrods of London beautiful leather luggage tags, which I'm going to be giving away for those of you who ask questions at the end. And again, these are wonderful luggage tags, which actually I've just found out when I was preparing for this speech that they were actually manufactured up the road in Long Island. They were then sent to Italy to a fine tannery where they were dyed with vegetable dyes, and I've brought them back across the pond to give out to you later. So please do get your thinking hats on. So where once Harrods offered amazing experiences in departments like the Pet Kingdom, tastes have changed. Experiences are now judged by exceptional customer service, where staff go the extra mile, delivering more than is expected. And Harrods is absolutely brilliant at this. But we now also have to offer and communicate amazing experiences through the development of creative content. And for a brand that's been around for over 180 years, it's vital to keep pace with technology and how your customer is consuming media, and therefore how they are consuming and buying into your brand. So Harrods has become a content creator to enable the brand to reach out to a sophisticated, tech-savvy international customer via its digital platforms and the web. It's also vital to invest in the young to appeal to the customer of the future, the next generation, the generation that's grown up with digital. As this slide demonstrates, Harrods has been in publishing for many years through catalogues, order books, and magazines. And 5 years ago, we resurrected our publishing division and we set up our own in-house section, which has grown dramatically from producing a quarterly glossy to publishing over 35 different print magazines last year, driven by our flagship Harrods magazine, which is read by over 300,000 loyalty customers every month. This has then developed into a digital version for mobile, for tablet, smartphones, across all platforms, including iPad and Android. And this isn't just a page-turning PDF, but a fully redesigned, repurposed content, especially formatted every month for the digital reader. It's just won several international awards, including the Best Fashion Magazine App and Best Customer Magazine App in the UK. So we're clearly on the right track. It's also common now that every photo shoot we do for our print titles, we take a video crew along too to capture the video content. So we own the assets to utilize cross-platform, whether that be in-store on our screen networks or online or on the app. And a good example of this is in the beauty halls, where 40% of Harrods customers shop, so one of the most important categories for the store. With average spends of over $3,000 per customer, with our rewards customers spending well over twice that amount, the beauty sector is vibrant. And each spring, we run a focus on beauty, preparing customers for summer with retail theatre, makeup artists, events on counter, plus masterclasses in private suites. And this is an opportunity to share the latest trends with customers to drive footfall and trade to the beauty halls. So our very talented and wonderful creative team were challenged with a campaign to support this. And in keeping with the colour trend in 2014, we ran the Colour Explosion campaign. And this brings to life a category which is traditionally promoted through lifestyle images, as opposed to focusing upon the actual product itself. We wanted to create a really powerful image that would gain high recognition across the store, whilst getting the colour story across to customers to engage and to fascinate, so that customers could be part of this trend and story. So this is the video that we produced, and while it's playing, I'll just tell the backstory to this. So this poor model had tons of powder being thrown at her from all angles. And for the model casting for this, we had five beautiful models lined up in our offices. And the art director and photographer had grains of couscous. And they were throwing the couscous at these poor girls. And the one that didn't flinch, and the one that didn't blink, she got the job. So if you're looking for an unflinching, unblinking, beautiful model, I can give you the name of the model agency later on. So this then plays out across the store on our 200 screen digital network on video walls, driving awareness and footfall to the beauty halls. Here you can see the most recent video wall installations, which show the campaign creative in all its glory on high definition, high bright screens. And the video walls have content that can be targeted via each floor so that relevant content can be played in the relevant areas across the store. And the still shots also appear in print in the magazine and on the cover shot. The same content is then included in our monthly app, consumed by customers who are on the move or are overseas via their mobile or tablets. And it's those customers that may be planning their next visit to the store who just want to find out what's happening and the latest trends. I think the other important thing here is about consistency. It's about consistency of message, consistency of image and branding, which breeds familiarity and recognition. Now, this content clearly had a dramatic effect on our customers. The retail results showed that colour finished as the top-selling category in September, which represented 30% of the overall beauty trade mix, plus a significant increase in trade, up 67% year-on-year, with brands like Tom Ford, Sensai, Dolce & Gabbana, Dior all trading significantly up. And we also ran a similar campaign last autumn when we launched the Beauty School with this Changing Faces content. Again, this plays out across our digital media platforms. It's fun, it's engaging, it's original, it's exclusive. And it makes a dynamic statement really about Harrods and our brand, appealing to our beauty and our fashion savvy customers. Digital also plays a vital part in the store takeovers that have taken place at Harrods. And over the past 3 years, Chanel, Christian Dior and Prada have each run hugely successful one-month brand takeovers. Now, these are part exhibition, part pop-up retail theatre, complete with limited edition exclusive product lines only available during the show. And these have all been immensely strong at driving trade, generating brand visibility and offering something different, something exciting, something new and exclusive. And for Harrods, it's about enticing new customers, but also keeping existing customers entertained, feeling loved and feeling special. Prada Sphere was the universe of Prada. It traced the company's multivarious obsessions from fashion and accessories to art, architecture, cinema, sport and beyond. And digital technology really formed the platform for the exhibition. Runway shows were color coordinated, especially forming on these giant LED walls in the exhibition, as you can see on these slides. Also, there was a huge array of digital screens which really charted the key moments in the brand's history, which encaptured the customers that came to see the show. And it was a really clever way of charting that whole timeline for the brand. Digital screens were also featured in the window displays surrounding the store. In-store digital networks and social media drove the awareness and the global PR. And again, the importance of social media behind these store takeover exhibitions is really important to attract the younger, fashion-conscious audience and keeping Harrods relevant and cool to this customer. Harrods' online retailing site, harrods.com, featured Prada Sphere with a dedicated landing page giving customers information about the exhibition. But no product was retailed. This was very much a store-driven initiative. And I'm sure we'll see much greater participation and influence in the future in tying in more dynamically to this type of store brand takeover. So the final example is the opening of our new department, Shoe Heaven, which happened in the autumn of 2014. And this was really, for Harrods, the most significant store development in a decade. It was designed by the late architect David Collins with an investment of over $50 million, with the aim to offer the ultimate in luxury retail experience for shoe shopping across the world. 42,000 square feet of new retail space included 17 plush boutiques presenting collections from over 50 different designers, from the likes of Chanel, Dior, Christian Louboutin, Manolo Blahnik, Louis Vuitton, and Valentino. It was all complete, very plush, with banquet lounge seating, private shopping suites, and beautifully edited shoe displays. And Shoe Heaven really does invite customers to experience a new way to shop, which is a little bit more five-star hotel than the traditional shoe department. So a creative campaign was developed, a girl on a trapeze climbing through the sky, adorned with a pair of exclusive heels up in the clouds, clearly in Shoe Heaven. And then this featured across the store through window displays, vinyls and mannequins. And within the store, visual merchandising showed shoebox cutouts cladding the main entrances into the store, again supported by digital screens. It featured on the video walls across the main escalators in the store, even on screens out onto the street so customers could interact with information. Landing page on Harrods.com, and then also in print and on the app. But as part of this campaign, one of the biggest challenges we had was how to really engage with the target customer of females aged 20 to 40 via social media. So we created a Candy Crush style of game, which turned out to be equally addictive and fun. It also offered a weekly prize for the highest score achieved, £500 pair of stiletto shoes, no less. As you can imagine, this did attract some significant interest. We also wanted to drive greater awareness and downloads to our magazine app. So to be able to get our great content out to this much wider audience. So the game Stiletto Wars was launched, and this is how it worked. So we were quite surprised and absolutely delighted when the press and media picked up on this and it went viral. We had over 1.3 million screen views, record download issues of the magazine app, as this was the only way that you could actually access the game. And this drove new customers to experience our digital magazine content. And this spike shows what happened when the UK newspaper's digital news roundup, Mail Online, featured it. And this all helped to create incredibly strong PR coverage around the launch. Shoe Heaven traded at plus 40% against budget, plus 58% up year on year, with social media reach of 18 million, 59,000 visits to Harrods.com, just under 200 pieces of international PR coverage. And Shoe Heaven also attracted this elusive new customer to Harrods, and much of this was down to the targeted social media and digital campaign behind this launch. So as you can imagine, we're feeling pretty pleased with ourselves, thinking that we'd cracked the holy grail of digital advertising and promotion to get more downloads, to get our content through following on from Stiletto Wars. So with Christmas coming up, we created another game called Don't Drop Your Baubles. This was a design your own tree concept with a winning entry selected by a group of designers, with the prize being a £500 Harrods gift card and your very own Harrods Christmas tree delivered to your door. Now, this is quite interesting because the game was fun, but it didn't quite engage the way that Stiletto Wars did. It didn't quite capture the imagination. The volume of downloads was quite a lot lower. And we put this down a little bit to the broader appeal, slightly less targeted approach, but it also wasn't backed up by a major marketing campaign. And of course, that vital press media pickup didn't happen. But despite this, we're undeterred. We're planning more games. We really feel there's something in gamification. And so we're planning some more games to happen in 2015 to help drive our app content. So hopefully, as you can see from my presentation today, that digital plays a very large part in everything that we do in terms of marketing Harrods to our customers. It influences how we create content and how we then play that content out. It also influences what channels we create in-store to broadcast and to match the digital channels that our customers engage with. So to conclude, I guess what we've learned is that we need to be constantly creating, reinventing, designing fun, engaging content that customers can interact with. We no longer sell exotic animals, but we need to find other ways in which to engage with the customer of today. And content really does help to create that special relationship and brand loyalty, which then has the huge opportunity to spread to a much wider group via social media channels. So for a store that's been in existence since 1830, which is more successful today than at any time in its long history, we've learned to constantly reinvent and create. You can't stand still. You need to keep innovating, keep creating, keep trying new things. They might not all work, but with enough energy, belief, and commitment, most of them will. And the key is about talking to customers in the way and the channel that they want to be talked to. So as the digital world continues to evolve, the biggest lesson we've learned is to make sure that we're part of it and not be left behind, especially for a brand like us that's been around for so long, with the false comfort of relying upon our history to retain loyalty and driving the customers of tomorrow. Thank you for listening. So I welcome Alan back onto the stage. We're going to have the Q&A.
Little Q&A to start with. Yep, have a seat.
Great. Well, thank you.
Did we have our two winners for the two stuffed animals? Can you raise your hands if you found the cards? Or did I hide them sufficiently well? We have one there. There's one over in this side, too. I put them right here. I know it's right over in there if you haven't seen it yet. We're going to have question and answer here for a little bit. We certainly welcome questions from the audience. We have three microphone stands. If you have a question, please come up to the stand and we'll call on you from the stage to entice you to ask us some good questions. Guy is giving us some more freebies. Do you want to tell him the story of the luggage tag?
Yes, so the luggage tags, as I mentioned earlier, will be, I've got a nice little bag behind the stage, so for those of you that do ask a question, you will receive your lovely luggage tag. Hopefully there won't be too many questions.
All right. See, anyone at the microphone? See someone standing? Yes, sir. Go right ahead. Why don't you start us off?
Thank you for your presentation. I was interested in knowing, learning, if you're doing any specific more targeted towards your tourist customer coming from overseas. I understand that more than 50% maybe of your sales is going to foreigners. I don't know whether they live in London or not, but are you doing any specific to attract more tourism through these kind of media?
Yeah, I think for us, we're between a rock and a hard place in many ways, because our tourist traffic is very high in terms of volume. And we work very closely with London Tourist Board and London Tourism to drive customers into the store. But I guess the challenge for us is all about funneling that traffic, because on some days we get such high volumes of that tourist traffic, which actually bother the other high value clients in terms of them looking for the more designer brands. So we've been quite careful in terms of designing the layout of the store to put adjacencies correctly that appeal to that particular customer of tourism. But interestingly, and I think what was fascinating for me when I asked people to put up their hands, of those of you that haven't heard of Harrods, we have this constant drive of tourists coming to the store. It really is very much an iconic place in London. So actually, we don't spend a great deal of time, effort, and investment in terms of marketing to that customer. But what we do is spend time marketing to the target markets overseas, where we see that affluent customer coming to the store.
Thank you very much. It was a good question. If you ask us a question, or if you have won one of the things we've given away on stage, please meet us at the end of the session outside the main doors. Unfortunately, or fortunately, we're going to have luncheon here at 12:30, but we have to clear the room out so the staff can set up for it. So we'll take all questions after the show, as well as the giveaways outside of the front door. So thank you for your question. Yes, we have a question over here.
Yes, thank you for the presentation. It was really great. I'm curious about the marketing you do with your mobile apps. Do you do anything within the store environment so that, you know, you see consumers walking around with their phones? I'm just curious if there's any, you know, local, like hyper-localized campaigns that you do with mobile for consumers that are in your store.
Yeah, we have some exciting plans this year to try and create more downloads in store. We have a slight challenge at the moment, because believe it or not, with it being such an old building, there are quite a few areas still where we don't have Wi-Fi enabled. So that's a big investment that we're looking to put in later on this year that'll make it so much easier. But in saying that, we use our digital screen networks around the store to push the app, to push the content. A lot of the content that you saw in the presentation, which appears on the app, also appears as editorial content across the screen networks. So we're trying to actually use our digital screen signage a little bit like a magazine. So we have Harrods editorial content, which is adjacent with advertising, paid for advertising. Whereas I think really up until fairly recently, we were just really running ad reels as opposed to the editorial. Clearly, there's a great opportunity for us with the kind of footfall that we have on a daily basis to drive more downloads to the app. And that's very much a big challenge for us this year. Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, please.
I was wondering, you spoke a lot about how you're using digital to change the shopping experience, but have you also, do you have some thoughts on how digital revolutions or new technologies are going to change the actual product offering that you have in terms of offering, for example, customized products or involving your customers more in other parts of the shopping rather than like more the product creation?
Yeah, I think we're seeing a lot of the brands and concessions within the store who are using digital with a one-to-one demonstration with their customers. So, you know, it's pretty common now for iPads to be in the kind of touch concepts that are being rolled out across the individual brands to give more in-depth information behind a product line or even indeed on for ordering and availability of products. I think we obviously have a big technology department within the store itself, so we're seeing a lot of innovation coming through there, which are more the consumer electronics products. But in terms of the actual clienteling and the individual retail sales directly to the customers, I think we're going to see an awful lot more of digital playing a part in that as part of that amazing customer experience that you have.
I think your question brings up a very interesting point. In the US, and we talked about this during some of our prep calls, you'll find that particularly in the earlier days of adoption, there was a lot of internal struggle about, you know, who would control it, or should we have digital? Is this really worth it? How do we determine ROI? Who gets to control it? There was a lot of tension and struggle. When I asked you if you had experienced that at Harrods, I thought your answer was quite surprising.
Yeah, I think Harrods has been incredibly forward-thinking and very supportive and has been really ready to invest in digital. I think where we have been struggling is a little bit trying to get the luxury brands on side who are actually quite conservative by their nature, quite rightly so, because they've got incredible amounts of brand heritage and history to protect. But it's taken us a little while to get those kind of luxury brands, particularly the fashion and jewelry brands, to actually engage with digital. I think there's a little bit of an element of lack of control. Sensitivities. I think also they're a bit concerned about adjacencies, so who's going to be before us, who's going to be after us, particularly when they're used to owning a certain amount of space or airtime. But we're seeing some results there. We're actually seeing some significant investments now from a few of the luxury brands, particularly brands like Cartier, who are investing a lot now in digital and really pushing the boundaries a bit more.
Yeah, I think that's a very interesting point. I think you have to wind up training the luxury brands to appreciate and respect and embrace digital, and I think from there is where you're going to start seeing the adoption that you were thinking of, which I think is an excellent point. It brings me to another question that we were talking about. The Economist in December had a wonderful issue talking about luxury brands. They had a whole special report on it. And one of the things they did, there was like a primary shift that was going on. Customers now seem to want experiences more than items, and that was one shift. The other shift was when they do want to purchase an item, they want it to be sustainably done, they want to have a story behind it, has to have some social consciousness behind it. Mm. How are you seeing digital play into that? How are you seeing digital working from being just an item, like Harrods being an item-based store, to being an experience?
I think, well. Firstly, luckily, you know, Harrods, for those of you that have visited the store, is absolutely an experience in itself. We have an average dwell time of customer of just under 2 hours, so people spend a long time there, We have over 30 restaurants in the store, so you know a lot of customers spend the whole day in the store. But we do see this trend happening. We are seeing that customers are demanding more information behind the sustainability, where products have been curated from, background to the designers. They really are very interested in this area, and we ran a couple of campaigns last year with NFC, Near Field Communication, where we had brands who were promoting through the shop display windows with these tags that could be downloaded onto smartphones for really more information that customers could take away to learn about the provenance, to learn about the designers and the curation and the history of these brands. So we're seeing that brands are really keen to tell their stories through mm-hmm. digital. And I think digital is a really great way for them to enable them to do this, particularly where they've got maybe old film footage or interviews. It gives a much richer experience for the customer.
Yes, sir.
Tayshan, I know Harrod is a lot about the in-store experience, as you just mentioned, but I also know you have e-commerce presence and a mobile site as well. You obviously had very high success with Stiletto Wars and creating that engagement. Were there any plans or are there any plans moving forward to really tie that with direct sales through your e-commerce channels?
Yeah, it's a great question. I think, yes, there are absolutely plans to bring the two closer together. I think at this stage, our e-commerce division has been run pretty independently from the store. It's quite supportive of the store, but it's also run as an independent channel. And I think as we move forward, we'll see the merging of the two together. And I think at this stage, we're still probably quite separate to that. But I think particularly with the kind of marketing and promotional channels that we're working on, you'll see a great deal more of the synergies coming together.
Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, sir.
Hello. I have a question regarding the games. So are there any customer research made behind the creation of this game? Because honestly speaking, I could hardly imagine the wife of Russian gas oil company owner playing this shoes game for a discount, and it could be just, I don't know, teenagers playing these games for the discount, and they will not come back for years, and it's just a waste of money.
Yeah, that's a possibility, but I think particularly for that particular game, we were looking to target the UK customer. It was admittedly the younger customer as well, so we wanted to have something that would appeal to that younger customer. Perhaps the more sophisticated Russian customer that you talk of might not appeal to her. But as far as we were concerned, it was a bit of fun. It was something new. It was something different. But and we felt it was quite successful.
Could you evaluate something, somehow the outcome of this game? So do you attract more people, really? Or
well, I think for us, the biggest thing was to get that PR awareness and coverage that was picked up in the press. And that really highlighted the fact that we were opening Shoe Heaven, the biggest shoe department in Europe. It was all about luxury shoe shopping, the way that we're changing shopping. So it was really about to drive that awareness and PR. Of course, we wanted those retail results to come through. And actually, since we've opened, we've been trading brilliantly well. So it's hugely successful.
Yeah, I think you're asking about like the actual metrics behind it. I think were you wondering how the measurements were going with that?
Yeah.
I think when we were talking about some of this, there's some things that I think might be under not as willing to discuss on stage.
Yeah.
But I certainly think that the awareness is really what you're driving after, and the 200 press mentions I certainly think would qualify as a resounding success. So, yes.
Yes, hi.
Thank you.
Over and above the e-commerce and m-commerce and all the new technology you want to bring in the store, in the flagship store, what is your international expansion strategy to bring the brand in other physical environments where we may find your customer, such as airports and other physical environments? Thanks.
Thank you. Harrods has an international presence, which you may be familiar with. There are a number of Harrods stores in various airports around the world. These are run really as license-operated premises, either through using the brand license or a wholesale agreement. Excuse me. But really, in terms of the view has always been that there is only one Harrods. And the store that you see in Knightsbridge, the Palace of Knightsbridge that I showed in the presentation, is very much the iconic destination in London. So I think to date, the strategy has been, let's not upset that amazing jewel in our crown, and let's not try and replicate something else in Dubai or in Shanghai or Chicago or New York. There have been, over the years, I mean, I've been at Harrods 11 years, and over the years there have been a number of different projects, a couple in this country, with a view to setting up a huge Harrods. But at present, the brand is being pushed out through a Harrods Hotels, a very upmarket boutique hotel concept, which is rolling out across the world, which has been announced last year. But in terms of a physical retail store, there are no plans as yet.
Yes, sir.
Thank you for the presentation, firstly. As you sought to reimagine the store and change the customer profile you're attracting, did you find any resistance or backlash from an existing customer profile?
Yeah, I mean, we have done to a certain extent. I think over the years, there are certain times of the year where Harrods is incredibly busy with certain nationalities. So, for example, we attract a lot of Middle Eastern customers during the summer period, and I think a lot of our local customers sometimes find that a little bit, occasionally a little bit overbearing. But we're very sensitive to that, and obviously we have to manage our local customers with our international customers. But it works both ways. You know, again, we have to be very careful and sensitive to the different nationalities that we have from all over the world. So hence, we have 180 different speakers in the store in terms of language speakers. I think we have over 100 Mandarin-speaking staff specifically to manage the Chinese customers. And for us, it's all about making those customers feel at home. And I think our staff really is a good microcosm, if you like, of our customers. We have staff from all over the world, and we have customers from all over the world. But I think the challenge for us in a marketing sense is that we have to nurture and look after our London, UK customers as well as our international customers. And sometimes that is a bit of a challenge.
One of the interesting things that came up during our conversations was the fact that your motto is everything for all people, everywhere. And yet Harrods is an iconic luxury brand. I mean, it is the temple, if you will. I think that's one of the words that we bandied about. Can you tell me how you reconcile your motto versus your target audience?
Yeah, so that motto has been in existence a long time, as we saw. I guess so much of it is really about affordable luxury. And so for anybody, it's our aim for any customer coming to Harrods that they walk out with a product which is the best in class. Even if you're coming for one of, you know, a small luggage tag, it's the best luggage tag that you can buy. So I guess also it's about aspirational luxury. You know, a lot of the customers that are coming to the store today that might not be spending $10,000 on a gown, that customer could spend $10,000 on a gown in the future. So it's all about nurturing that customer for the future and giving everybody that great experience. But for us, it's about affordable luxury, not necessarily the most expensive. Exclusivity is a really big issue for, I think, most luxury department stores. We work very hard and with many of our brands to achieve exclusive ranges, exclusive product, even for limited periods of time where it's only available at Harrods.
All right, do we have any other questions for Guy before we wrap up the session this morning? Well, thank you very much for coming out. How about another